If you have generated parts using Sketcher and Part Design, you can now learn how to finish your design by assembling the parts using the Assembly Design Workbench. It is recommended to begin first with Sketcher and Part Design Workbenches. You can follow the link above. Before we discuss the detailed instructions for using the Assembly Workbench, you need to follow the instructions as you progress. The following scenario aims at giving you a feel for what you can do with an assembly document. The Getting Started section is composed of the listed tasks. We will go over them one by one. If you would have any questions, please feel free to write it on the comments section. Now let's get started. Entering Assembly Design Workbench and opening a CATProduct document. This task shows you how to enter Assembly Design Workbench and open an existing product. Select Start. Mechanical Design. Assembly Design command to launch the required workbench. The workbench is opened. The commands for assembling parts are available in the toolbar to the right of the application window. You can notice that product 1 is displayed in the specification tree, indicating the building block of the assembly to be created. Before following the scenario, set the following options. Make sure the option Work with the cache system option is deactivated. Use the Tools Options command. Click Infrastructure. Product structure to the left of the dialog box and uncheck the option Work with the cache system. Now click the Product Structure tab and uncheck the option Manual Input. Click Part Infrastructure to the left of the dialog box and then check the option Keep Link with selected object. For the purposes of this scenario, set the automatic mode for update. Do not forget to restart the application after the changes. In the description, you can find the link for the CAD models used in the tutorial. Please put all CAD models in the same folder. Now you can open the assembly _01.catproduct document. Start the scenario with an existing assembly. Product 1 is composed of 3 parts created in the Part Design Workbench. Frame in turquoise. Branch 3 in blue. Branch 1 in red. From now on, these parts are referred to as components. Surface and coincidence constraints have been defined for these parts in the assembly workbench. Click the plus sign to the left of the constraints text in the tree and apply the show mode on these constraints if you wish to view them in the geometry area. Fixing a component. This task shows you how to set the first constraint. This operation consists in fixing the position of a component in space so as to use this component as the base of the assembly. Select Frame Component in the specification tree or in the geometry area. Click the Fix Component icon in the Constraints toolbar. The component frame is fixed immediately. The application indicates this by displaying a green anchor symbol. Note also that the constraints branch now displays the new constraint. The anchor symbol is preceded by a lock symbol to make a distinction between fix in space and fix operations. Inserting an existing component. This task shows you how to insert an existing component into the assembly. Select Assembly 01 in the specification tree. Click the existing component icon. The file selection dialog box appears. Select sub_product1catproduct from the directory and click open. A new component is added to the specification tree. The assembly now includes 4 components, 3 parts and a sub-assembly. This is the component you have just imported. Setting constraints between components. This task consists in setting a coincidence constraint, then a contact constraint between the component you have just inserted, sub_product1, and branch1. Click the coincidence icon. The following message window appears, providing information on the coincidence constraint command. If you do not want to see this dialog box appear anymore, check Do Not Prompt in the future. Select Access Publication in the specification tree. The application detects it once selected. The access is now highlighted in the geometry. Select one of the two interfaces of branch 1 to select the associated access. As the coincidence constraint is created, screw and branch 1 are aligned. Now, you are going to set a contact constraint between screw and a circular face of branch 1. Click the contact constraint icon. Select face publication in the specification tree. Select the red circular face in the direction opposite to the published face. As the contact constraint is created, the turquoise cylinder is located exactly on the red face. The created constraints are automatically updated because the automatic update mode is activated. As the color defining valid constraints is green, our constraints are green. The assembly now looks like this. Moving constrained components using the compass. This task consists of manipulating the assembly to check if the components react the way we want, for example, according to the constraints we set in the previous task. Select the red patch at the center of the compass and drag it onto screw. As the compass is snapped to the component, you can manipulate the component. Now, if you press and hold down the Shift key and select VZ axis on the compass, then drag and drop the component up and down, you can see that three components are moving. Repeat the operation as many times as you wish. The assembly reacts correctly. Frame does not move because it is fixed. The other three components can move. Release the left mouse button before releasing the Shift key. Drag the compass away from the selected object and drop it. Adding and renaming a new component. This task consists of adding a new component to the assembly and renaming this component. This component is a part created in the Part Design Workbench. Click assembly_01 and select the part icon in the Product Structure Tools toolbar. The new Part Origin Point dialog box appears, presenting two possible options. Either you define the point of your choice to locate the new part, or you use the origin point of the assembly as the origin point to be used for the part. Click No to use the origin point of the assembly. The new component part 2 is now displayed in the specification tree. If the manual input option is activated, the part number dialog box appears before the new part origin point dialog box and lets you enter the name of your choice. Right-click part 2 and select the properties contextual command. In the Properties dialog box that appears, there are fields in Product tab where you can enter the information you required. Enter CII_join.1 in the instance name field and CII_join in the part number field. Click OK to validate the operation. The new names are now displayed in the specification tree. Designing a part in an assembly context. This task consists of designing the part you have just added to the assembly. It shows how to access the tools required for designing components in an assembly context. Double-click Join Part in the specification tree to access the Part Design Workbench. Select the blue faces shown and click the sketch icon to access the Sketcher Workbench. Now that you are in the Sketcher, click the normal view icon in the View toolbar and sketch a circle on the face using the circle command. Do not bother about positioning the circle. Now we need to obtain the same radius value as the one used for branch 3 circular edge. To make sure that this circular edge and the circle share the same axis, use the constraints defined in dialog box command to create a coincidence constraint. Select the circle if not already done, and the circular edge, then click the constraint defined in dialog box command and check coincidence. After validating the operation, the circle is coincident with the circular edge. Exit the sketcher and use the pad command with the up to plane option to extrude the sketched circle. Select the blue faces shown to specify the limit of the pad. After validating the operation, you should obtain this cylinder. The part is designed. Editing a parameter. This task shows you how to edit the diameter of the pocket belonging to branch 3. You can see how this editing affects the part you created in the previous task. Double-click branch 3 to access the part design workbench. Select Pocket 2 and use the Pocket 2 object, Edit Parameters contextual command to display the associated parameters. Double-click D11 in the geometry area to display the constraint addition dialog box. Enter 20 as the new diameter value and click OK to generate the new pocket. Click Update if change doesn't take effect. Update assembly 01 by double-clicking in the specification tree. Join part is modified accordingly. The coincidence previously set between the two parts is maintained. This result is made possible thanks to the option Keep Link with selected object you set at the very beginning of the scenario. Replacing a component. This task shows you how to replace sub_product1 cat product by another component. Select sub_product1 cat product in the specification tree. Click the Replace Component icon in the Product Structure Tools toolbar. In the dialog box that appears, select sub_product2 cat product as the replacement component and click Open. The Impacts on Replace dialog box is displayed. Check Yes to replace all instances of the selected element and click OK to confirm. Sub_product1 cat product is no longer visible. This is sub_product2 cat product. If necessary, update the document. Note that the coincidence constraint is maintained. This is due to the publication of the axis used in the constraint definition. As the axis is a published element, the application can reconnect the constraint. Conversely, the contact constraint is broken. You will learn how to reconnect it later. Analyzing assembly constraints. This task shows you how to analyze the status of all assembly constraints defined for assembly 01. Select the Analyze Constraints command. The Constraints Analysis dialog box that appears displays all the information you need. The Constraints tab contains a detailed status of the assembly, the number of non-constrained components, and the status of the defined constraints. Click the Broken tab to see the list of broken constraints. We have only one broken constraint, the contact constraint. Click on the name of the constraint. The constraint is highlighted in the specification tree. Click on OK to close the dialog box. Reconnecting this contact constraint is our next task. Reconnecting a broken constraint. This task shows you how to reconnect the broken constraint detected by the application. Double-click the broken constraint in the specification tree. Note that this broken constraint is indicated by a yellow warning symbol. In the constraint definition dialog box that appears, click more to access additional information. Click disconnected in the status frame, then reconnect. You are then prompted to select a component to rebuild the constraint. Select the same faces as the ones used for setting the first contact constraint. Click OK to validate the operation and update the document. The constraint is reconnected. Detecting clashes. This task shows you how to detect possible clashes between two components. Select branch 1 in the specification tree. Select the Analyze Compute Clash command. The Clash Detection dialog box appears. It displays the first component selected for computing possible clashes. As you need another component, select sub_product2 using the control key. This component also appears in the dialog box. Click Apply to compute clashes. The application detects a clash between the brown cylinder and the red face. This is indicated by two red circles in the geometry, as shown. The result of the computation also appears in the dialog box. Click Cancel to close the dialog box. Well, now that you know that your assembly needs to be modified to work properly, let's edit the cylinder. Editing a component. This task shows you how to edit the component causing the problem. Double-click the brown cylinder to access the part design workbench. Double-click the cylinder again to edit it. The part definition dialog box is displayed. Enter 20 mm to reduce the pad length and click OK. The cylinder is updated and now looks like this. Exploding the assembly. This last task illustrates the use of the explode capability. Exploding the view of an assembly means separating the components of this assembly to see their relationships. Make sure assembly 01 is selected. Click the explode icon in the move toolbar. The explode dialog box is displayed. Assembly 01 is the assembly to be exploded. The depth parameter lets you choose between a total, all levels, or partial, first level, exploded view. Set all levels if not already set. Set 3D to define the explode type. Click Apply to perform the operation. The scroll explode field gradually displays the progress of the operation. The application assigns directions and distance. Once complete, the assembly looks like this. The usefulness of this operation lies in the ability of viewing all components separately. Note that you can move products within the exploded view using the 3D compass. Click OK to validate the operation and then click Yes at the prompt or click Cancel to restore the original view. Congratulations, you have done all the tasks of the Getting Started section. Check for the tutorials about Assembly Workbench or other tutorials for different workbenches.